The ancient Sumerians, the creators of the first civilization, told a myth about its origins. It was, they said, a devil's bargain. It offered the noblest ideals of humanity, but also brought violence, greed, and destruction. All of this is civilization, the Sumerian god of wisdom told humanity. And if you wish its benefits, you have to take all of its qualities. And once accepted, you cannot give them back, and it's up to you to use with restraint and with wisdom. Now, what we have to understand is that the Greeks had a penchant for going back to the first cause because they knew if we didn't make the first mistake, we wouldn't make the second and the third and the fourth, etc., etc. And I, too, have a penchant to go back to the first cause. And I've been spending the last 26 years of my life trying to figure that out. We have to understand that when you look at civilization, what the Greeks were really talking about here was the advent of fire. This is how we opted out of nature. We did something that broke us away from who we are. And there's not one thing we could have done as an action in the second stage of knowledge that could have done that except cooking. There is no other answer. I've looked all over the place and I've had all sorts of people tell me answers, and they always go back up into the first stage trying to figure out, well, why did we make a bad application? Yeah, we need to know that, don't we? And that would have been what started everything. But how do you correct that? And what was it? We don't know. But do we know what we're doing? I think we do. I know what we're doing. We're destroying a nutrient that feeds one of our senses. We lost one of our senses. It explains everything. Why do we have a dark side to our behavior? Why do we allow 40,000 children to die every day? If you just stop and think about that right now, and if that doesn't make you outraged, what is wrong with you? Why do you think I scream and yell like I do? Because I get in the moment and I'm aware of the suffering, and it drives me bananas and it wears me out. But I'm trying to convince you people how important this is. If what I'm saying is true, how can I calmly talk about any of this without absolutely wanting to pull my hair out? You know, I feel connected to everything else around me, but the people, the things I'm supposed to be connected to the most, my fellow people, you're not connected. Your biophoton levels are too low. And I know what would happen if they were all high. Oh, I visualize the paradise we could have. I know what would happen if we were all eating the right food, and we'd wake up and someone would have a brilliant idea over here, and the next thing you know, everyone would know about it. Because that's what we'd be talking about. I mean, that's, oh my God. You know, you think of that movie Avatar. I remember when I watched the movie Avatar, and you see the guy grab his tail and he connects it up to the other animal, makes that connection. We don't need that. That's old school internet. Plug it into the internet, right? The telephone line. We have a wireless connection. Those are biophotons. And that's the first thing I thought of. And that movie was so beautiful because it explained the interconnectedness of things. That's what reality is. We all are a one. We are all one. And we can't sense it and feel it. And you can't intellectualize about it. You can focus on the little bitty biophotons you got, and you can improve on it. Like, you can squint and see better. Or you go, hey, what? Yeah, we can focus on those, but we're not supposed to. This is why we struggle. We shouldn't have to think about being kind. We shouldn't be told to be giving and loving. We shouldn't be told to cooperate. We shouldn't be given 7 spiritual laws. We shouldn't be given 10 commandments. These are all given if we were connected. The first step that I perfected is an idea as time has come, because not enough people are willing to embrace a raw vegan diet. Not enough people are willing to embrace a water fast. But my God, a juice fast, piece of cake. And the greatest thing about it is you're not hungry, energy level skyrockets, you poop your brains out, you lose a lot of weight, your skin goes through a transformation you won't believe. Stretch marks disappear, varicose veins disappear. I had scars disappear on my body. One on my leg that I can no longer feel, it was elevated, I can barely see it. We heal from the inside out. As long as we got garbage on the inside, our outside really takes the back seat to healing. Hello, my name is John Rose, and in this video, I'd like to take a closer look at the paleo diet, and I have a really serious question that I'd like to ask for everyone who follows the paleo diet. Why do you want to be a caveman? Is this really your version of an ideal world where we could freeze to death, and we have to wear dead animal skins to make sure we don't freeze to death, and there's not enough plant food to eat, so we have to chase down and kill an animal and then eat the animal. How would we eat the animal? Could we eat it raw? Oh, that's disgusting. Well, if we put it in fire, maybe we can eat it. Is that what we do? Is that your vision of an ideal world? It's not mine. My vision of an ideal world is being on an island somewhere where there's so much abundance of food to eat that I just could go anywhere I wanted to and there'd be plenty to eat everywhere. And I knew that I really only had one main job that day I had to do. Everyone had to do it. It was a rule everywhere. And no one had to be told to do it because it was an automatic. And all we had to do is go out there and eat the food that we're designed to eat that has a symbiotic relationship with us. And then once we eat that food, we find the one seed that's the best out of everything we ate. And if we can't find a good one, we go to our stash and find one of those heirlooms. And then we go out somewhere and plant that seed in the best place we know to plant it. Because we know it needs certain soil, and we can tell by the greens that are growing in the ground at the time, and there's a symbiotic relationship with those. And this would be common knowledge because we'd be passing it down generation after generation. For seven generations at least, we would know how to plan and prepare for everything around us by only doing one thing. We only had one job. We had to go plant our seeds. That's why there's a symbiotic relationship with fruit. It's the only food that wants us to eat it. And if we did that, we would live in paradise because we would all be connected. We wouldn't have the wrong mentality. We wouldn't be eating animals. We wouldn't have any animal abuse. We wouldn't have war and crime and violence and heart disease and cancer and diabetes. And it's really that simple. Sounds too simple, but think about it. Everything that is profound is supposed to be simple. So when we look for the most profound thing of all, the solution to solve most of our problems, it's supposed to be something as simple as we're not supposed to cook your food. Hello, my name is John Rose, and in this video I'd like to take a closer look at why fire is actually a devil's bargain. And I say that because with all new technology, with all those things that we master, they all have the potential for evil. Whenever we apply those things we master, any new technology, to some of the things we need, and that's unfortunately what we have done. Now I've identified 11 main events that have drastically changed the fate of mankind. And it all started with the first main event that happened about 2 million years ago. And that's when our brains nearly doubled in size, going from about 800 cc's, 400 cc's to about 800 cc's. Then, with that brilliant mind, we were able to master five things that we never mastered before. And with all new knowledge comes the potential for evil. I'm trying to get out of the sun. Can you see my face? Comes the potential for evil. And then I've identified five main things that we mastered. And then with all that new knowledge comes the potential for evil. If we apply any one of these five things, can you see my hand? All I see is white. When we apply those five things we master to one of our needs, and that's what we did. So there are five bad applications. Now, the first bad application is the fall of mankind. The world revolves this, so we hear a lot of bullshit. You remember, our brains are bombarded by bullshit all the time. That, oh, the first bad application we made, the fall of mankind, is actually what made our brains double in size. No, man, you got the sequence wrong. We didn't have the brain power to cook our food. We didn't have the brain power to even master fire yet. The sequence is wrong. There are 11 main events. The first one happened on the 67-yard line into our existence. If we put our human existence on a football field, where there's 100 yards and then 3 feet per yard. We went two-thirds into our existence, 4 million years. 2 million years ago is when, let's go this way. So we football field, here's the zero line, and there's the 100-yard line, which is also the zero line. But we go this way, two-thirds, let's round up to the 67-yard line. That's when our brains doubled in size. We can speculate why that happened. We're not sure. I believe it was the fat that was in coconuts, because it's mostly lauric acid, just like the fat that's in mother's milk. Anyway, that was the 67-yard line. Then we went another 1.2 million years on this football field, another 20 yards all the way down to the 87-yard line approximately, and that's when we finally mastered fire. That's close to 800,000 years ago. Now, what a lot of people are trying to say is, no, we mastered fire 2 million years ago, and we started cooking our food 2 million years ago, then our brains doubled in size. No, there's no proof for that. There's no proof that we ever mastered fire back then, and then the sequence doesn't make sense. There's no logic in their sequence. But most people don't know this, so they trick us and fool us and saying, oh, cooking's good. No, it's not a devil's bargain. It's all good, 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 good. Cooking's a good application. No, it's a bad application. It's the original sin. It's the fall of mankind. It's why we suffer. It destroys biophotons. That's why we lost one of our senses. We're supposed to have six senses, not five. That's why we have problems. We are a six-sense species living in a five-sense reality, and we struggle because of that. We don't know how to act. We got the wrong mentality. So, with fire comes a devil's bargain. Look at all the good things you can do with it. It did amazing things. Fire did. But again, with all new technology, with all new knowledge, we can use it the wrong way, and we did when we altered our food with it. So that's the third main event, and is the first big mistake, the first bad application to the first thing we mastered. But remember, there's four more things we mastered. Since we mastered fire, and that again was on the 87-yard line, we made that first bad application. Let's go back this way. Remember, 0, 67, our brains doubled in size, 87, mastered fire. Then we went about another 12 yards down to the 1-yard line. 99% into existence is when we finally made that very first bad application, about 60,000 years ago. It represents 1% of our existence. That's when we mastered fire. So people say, we're supposed to be eating cooked food. No, we live 99% of our existence on a raw vegan diet. This is not a fad diet. This is ridiculous. Oh, fasting is a fad, raw vegan diet's a fad, vegetarianism is a fad. Well, vegetarianism might be because it has to do with the third mistake we made, which I'm getting to in just a moment. So here we are down on the 1-yard line. We start cooking our food 60,000 years ago. What'd we do? Well, in another 10,000 years, another 6 inches, down to the 2.5-foot line, there's 3 feet in a yard. So another 10,000 yards, 50,000 years ago, we used fire to hunt animals. We started eating animals consistently. We actually started eating animals way back on the 83-yard line. That's when we first started eating them, if you go from 0 to 83, but not consistently. It wasn't until we had something to hunt them with, fire, that we started eating animals consistently. And that's the 2.5-foot line. Then we had another 2 feet, another 40,000 years, all the way down to the 6-inch line. That's 10,000 years ago. That's the agricultural revolution. That's when we started eating plants that were not biologically adapted to eat. And then you have fools say, oh, look at us. Ever since civilization, we've been, civilizations have lived on this diet. Yeah, after post 1 of 5, 5 main mistakes, post 1 of 5, after the fall of mankind. You're talking about what happened after the fall of mankind? I don't give a hoot what people are doing after the fall of mankind unless it has to do with going back before the fall of mankind. So the third thing we mastered on the 6-inch line, the agriculture revolution, 10,000 years ago, is when we started eating plants that were not biologically adapted to eat. And guess what happened? All the nations that ate the plants instead of the animals did much better, didn't they? They did, they exceeded in every area. In science and education and art and music, in every area except two, their warlike tendencies and their obsession with sex. Now, put things in perspective, that's the 6-inch line. That's when we moved into farm communities. That's what led to moving into cities on the 3-inch line about 5,000 years ago. And the creators of the very first civilization told a myth about its origins. They said it was a devil's bargain. With all the great noble things we get, we also get all the bad things. It's a devil's bargain, don't you see? They're referring not to actually moving into the cities, but the actual invent of fire. That's the unwise use. That's the mistake we're making. The unwise use of fire is why we live in the Dark Ages. We're applying it to our food, bad application. It destroys the biophotons just to get you going. You can throw the biophoton theory out, or that part of the explanation completely out, and it still does enough damage to say, I don't want to do that to my food. Lose half the protein, 30 to 70% of the vitamins, up to 40% of the minerals, depending on how you cook it. Antioxidants, now, there are a couple of them that increase, and idiots say, well, look, if we get more of this and more of that, we'll be cooking our food, but there's tens of thousands of other things we're losing. It's not a fair trade, but that's not what we want to hear. If we just hear, oh, one or two things, that's it. Oh, more lycopene, more beta carotene. It's ridiculous. Cooking destroys everything. And we have not realized all of its ramifications. There are a lot of people who adopt a raw food diet and they still haven't understood all of its ramifications and how it goes back to the first cause. And if we didn't make that first mistake, if we didn't start cooking our food, we wouldn't have started eating animals. We wouldn't have started eating grains. And then there's two more mistakes on this football field we haven't talked about. They have to do with the Industrial Revolution. I already talked about the Agricultural Revolution. I might even call it the Industrial Revolution. I think I did. The Agricultural Revolution was on the 6-inch line. That's 10,000 years ago. Then the Industrial Revolution, and I keep meaning to update these numbers, happened like on the 1/14th of an inch line. And I calculated this about 10 years ago, so it might need to be updated a little bit. And then the last thing we mastered, and made a bad application to, the Industrial Revolution mastered machines, started eating processed foods. The last thing was the Chemical Revolution. And that's when we started growing our food on artificial fertilizers, spraying them with pesticides. That right there destroys 83% of the biophotons. It's magic, it looks like food, but it's not. So you don't want to eat conventional produce, any type of food that's not organic. All of our food should be organic. We shouldn't have to distinguish between the two. It should be against the law to sell any food that's inferior. It's the only thing that really matters on our planet is the quality of our environment. We're living systems are subject to the laws of nature, and the environment is our external metabolism. It's our context. We depend on our context. The quality of our life depends on the quality of our context. What's the quality of the air? What's the quality of water? Food, what have we done? Are you altering your food? Is it natural? No, it's not. Our food is unnatural. As a result, we are unnatural. We have a dark side to our behavior, which is not part of our DNA, it's not part of our nature. We don't have a propensity for evil. We eat our way to evil. As I mentioned before, we might not be able to eat our way to God, but we can sure eat our way to hell. But if we don't want to be in hell, we got to eat our way out of it, just like we ate our way into it. And how do we do that? We do a solid food vacation. Or we eat a raw vegan diet, but that's so hard. The best way to do it is start with a solid food vacation. Hello, my name is John Rose, and this is a special call to all the vegans and vegetarians on this planet worldwide who have a genuine, sincere passion to want to get people to stop eating animals. Because most of us know it's not a very loving thing to do, and it causes a lot of problems individually and environmentally. And I've got great news for you guys. I've got a great game plan to help you get more people not eating animals. And it's only something that they're going to do on a temporary basis, and more of them are going to be willing to do it. And this is the problem. We got to reach the tipping point. And most people, you can't get enough people to do the vegetarian diet to reach the tipping point. And I've identified 5 main mistakes we're making that are causing most of our problems. We got to correct the first mistake. That's the big one. Eating animals is the second mistake. And my protocol corrects all 5 on a temporary basis just so we can see what we're missing. And the problem with these 5 mistakes is a lot of us don't think we should make that the second mistake isn't a mistake. A lot of people don't think the third mistake is a mistake. You see where I'm headed with this? So there's a lot of denial out there. And the only way to really get people's attention is to get them to do something on a temporary basis so they can see what they're missing. Because the vast majority of us on this planet are not in a position to evaluate what we're doing and what we need to do, because we don't know what we're missing. We see results about 10 times faster. We don't have the type of cleansing reactions that most people do when they start eating a cleaner diet. And then we don't battle with the catabolism and anabolism process, because you're consuming more food in one day in liquid form than you could consume in 3 or 4 days when you're trying to transition from where most people are to where they need to be, because they can't process that much fiber. So this is the best transition. People always wonder, how do you go from where we're at to where we need to be? Oh, that's too quick. It'll shock the system. It's just the opposite. I understand what happens when we give ourselves a solid food vacation. I've worked with people who were cattle ranchers, and they had no intentions of giving up meat until they did a 30-day juice fast. And they were singing a whole different tune because they realized, hey, I was missing out on this. A few minutes here ain't worth what I get all day long when I start feeling connected to everything. That's what happens when you don't cook your food. A lot of people, now I postulated this and suggested this to many vegans over the years, and they always say, oh, It's hard enough to get them to go vegan. It'd be impossible to get them to go raw vegan because I'm not going to do it. Well, they're saying that because they don't know what they're missing. So all you vegans need to do this more than anyone else, because the vegans and vegetarians, this is why this is a special call to you guys. You guys have the potential to be the majority of the trim tab to our society to keep us from going off the cliff or running into that iceberg. If our society was a ship heading for an iceberg, there's a big rudder on it, 6 or 7, 8 stories tall, and on the rudder is a rudder, it's a trim tab. I want you guys to be the trim tab. You guys are in a better position to stop making the first mistake than the meat eaters are, because you've seen the improvement by improving your diet. And I'm saying that because I made 2 major dietary changes. The first one is what you guys did. I did that 30 years ago. But then I took the next logical progression, and I stopped cooking my food. It only made sense to me, and I did it, and it makes sense. I've been doing it 26 years. I just celebrated my 26th birthday, June 1st. My 30th vegan anniversary, January 1st. And I'll be 62 years old in 8 days, a week from tomorrow. And I don't ever remember feeling this good in my life. I'm running upstairs effortlessly now, faster. My feet are moving faster than I ever remember moving. I gotta go out and time myself because I think I might be able to break my record in high school. Anyway, this is so much worth it. One of the reasons why the vegetarian movement is not that successful is you guys just don't have a good enough message. It's incomplete. You're sort of like the 6 blind men who find that elephant. Remember, they all have limited perspectives. They all only feel one thing. And even though they're all right, they're all wrong. So anytime you don't have a complete story, a complete picture, hey, you shouldn't make the second mistake, what about the other 4? Then it's an incomplete story. And you're not gonna do good at selling it to people because it's not that good of a program. A lot of vegetarians aren't doing that good. The vegan's much better. But even then, you're eating too much processed foods. You go to tofu and fake proteins. We're not supposed to cook our food. It's that simple. And that's the major state of denial we have to outgrow. We have to realize, what is the fall of mankind? I've asked this to everybody who says, oh, cooking is not the fall of mankind. I said, well, you tell me what it is. And no one can tell me what is in the second stage of knowledge. I don't want to hear what's in the first stage or in between the doorway that precedes this. We can only speculate why we made the mistake. What in the hell is the mistake? You tell me. Put your comment down below. If you don't think cooking is the fall of mankind, tell me what it is. What did we do that changed everything about ourselves? It made us evil. How did it make us evil? Because we opted out of nature. We're no longer living the way nature intended. We're not satisfying our needs. We're supposed to eat natural food, unaltered food. We're not doing that anymore. We're not eating food we're biologically adapted to eat. So you vegans and vegetarians, if you're eating grains, we're not granivores. You got to cook it to eat it unless you sprout it. So who's in denial? If you guys are frustrated, if all you vegans and vegetarians are frustrated trying to convince a meat eater to go vegan, that's how raw vegans feel about vegans. Why can't you see you're still making a mistake? Why aren't you willing to give it a try? So that's all I ask of anybody. I know how hard it is to change. That's why I address the willingness issue with my first step. By eating meat, that guarantees your children aren't going to have a future. By eating grains, it guarantees your children aren't going to have a future. Why? Because those two food choices are not environmentally friendly. Oh, but wait a second, John. We vegans, we know, we cookies over here. We know that 40 of us can live on the same amount of land and water as that carnivore over there, that meat eater. Yeah, well, do you know that 2.5 raw vegans can live on the same amount of land and water as you? And that means 100 times that of a meat eater. But do you realize what you're doing by eating grains? Do you really understand how environmentally unfriendly that is? Do you realize that we have wiped out the forest in a 10,000 year period of time since we started eating grains, all the way from Spain to India. And America only took 300 years. We're not supposed to have grains of corn and soy. That's not what we're supposed to have on this planet. That's two dimensional compared to a forest that's three dimensional. You care about animals. Why are you cutting down their habitat, the forest that can So much life and animals can live in a forest. How much can live in a cornfield? Hello, my name is John Rose. And in this video, I'd like to take a closer look at some common concerns a lot of people have with our ideal diet of raw vegan plant food. And I'm going to take advantage of this video to reply to a comment I got this morning that I read where a woman had four really good concerns about eating a raw food diet. Her first concern had to do with the fact that what we eat depends on where we live, and that's very true. Her second concern was that there's just not enough fruit to feed the world, and currently that is true, but that won't be true in the future. Her third concern was that fruit will not provide us what we need for strength and for energy. And fourth, she said that God gave us starchy vegetables, grains, and legumes. And let's work backwards on that one. God did not give us the anatomy to eat grains. We don't have crops. We don't have gizzards. And God didn't make a mistake and forget to put a stove on our back, which is the only way we can eat those foods. We weren't eating those foods in the Garden of Eden. That's when we had paradise. The only time the Bible actually tells us what to eat is Genesis 1:29, and it was a raw vegan diet. We weren't eating animals, and we weren't eating cooked food in the garden, which was a place where we didn't have any problems that were within our control, which is attainable again if we stop eating the wrong food. So, God did not give us the anatomy to eat grains. We're not granivores. We are clearly frugivores like all the other primates on this planet. Same anatomy. Working back upwards, fruit doesn't give us the energy and the strength we need. Well, as a world-class athlete, I can tell you that's totally false. I've made two major dietary changes. The first one, I went vegan. Yes, my endurance level skyrocketed, going from a sad diet to a plant-based diet. But then when I went raw, it's a huge difference, much better. I've coached lots of athletes, world-class athletes, who go raw and they go from finishing mid-pack to winning every race. And you can go down to the description box below and watch a video when I was on the Deborah Duncan Show. One of my six students that came on there was a professional mountain biker. And he says, I saw John on TV. What he said makes sense. I stopped using pasta and grains to carbo load, where I was only finishing mid-pack, and did a 30-day juice fast and started eating fruits to carbo load. Now I'm winning every race or coming in second place. So the fact that we do better on our ideal diet only makes sense. There's plenty of energy in fruit if you know how to eat enough of it. A lot of people don't. They don't realize how much they have to eat, and they're not used to doing it. As a world-class athlete, I can tell you right now, I have no problem sitting down and eating a lot of food because I earn my food. I get out there and go for long bike rides. When I'm finished, I'm hungry. A lot of you people don't have much of an appetite because you're not doing anything. Get off your butt, develop an appetite, and let's see how much you can eat then. So we know that God didn't give us the anatomy, so that premise is false. We know that the best food for endurance athletes, all peak performance athletes, is our ideal diet, no question. And then, is there enough fruit to feed the planet? No, not right now. As I've mentioned before, we don't live in ideal times anymore. We've damaged society and the environment. Food should be grown everywhere. And if we can ever reach the tipping point, we'll get to a point where we will play our role as the guardians on this planet and make sure everybody has their needs met. We have the technology now where we can actually still live where we're living and have food flown into us, but that's not ideal. So let's go to her very first concern, which is a really interesting concern that we have to address. What we eat depends on where we live. Yes, very, very true. For example, 40,000 children die every day because of where they live. Why aren't they eating their fruits and vegetables? Why aren't we feeding them is the bigger question. What's wrong with us? Something is wrong with us, and what's wrong with us is we're eating cooked food. So this is what people don't get. If you don't have the big picture, you don't understand the simple solution and how important raw food is. Sure, you can find a lot of reasons why it seems like raw food's not going to work and it's not for everyone. And that's a valid point. How can you feed everybody raw food? We're not set up to do that right now. This is going to be, we got to reach the tipping point. Number one, that's why I say this over and over and over. Things will never change unless we reach the tipping point. Once we reach the tipping point, then things will change so fast, the majority of us will be doing this. Everyone will start to realize that we're connected to everything around us, and there's only one way to improve the quality of our lives, and that's to make everything around us better. That's when we become the guardians we were meant to be. We're not doing a very good job right now. Once we get our act together and we become the guardians we're meant to be on this planet, our main goal and role is to make sure everything has their needs met. And we make everything better. And we give and we give. And the more you give, the more you receive. We got the wrong mentality, which comes from eating the cooked food. So what do we do in the meantime? Well, we got to do damage control. That's why I say over and over and over, there's two groups of needs we must satisfy. We got to go upstream, get reconnected. We got to go downstream, deal with the damage we've done to ourselves and the society and the environment. We should have food growing everywhere. There's no reason why there shouldn't be berries everywhere, and these can't be fruit trees, and that should be every, you know, we should be able to do that everywhere on this planet. And if you're living in a place where you can't grow those trees, what does that tell you? If that's our ideal diet, then you're not living in our ideal world or where you're supposed to live. So an ideal diet only works in an ideal world, and we no longer live in an ideal world anymore. That's why we have another group of needs. If you're in England, for example, you're probably not getting enough sunshine. You need vitamin D. Is that an excuse to say, I got to eat the animals because that's not our ideal diet? I got to supplement it. Apparently, it's not our ideal diet. No, we have two groups of needs based on two anatomical limitations. We have to respect our first anatomical limitations. We have a species-specific diet. It doesn't include animals and grains and processed foods and chemicals. And it doesn't include cooking our food. No animal is supposed to cook their food, period. Now, she pointed out that raw food is therefore not for everybody because where they live too far north. Try to convince the Eskimos to eat raw food. Well, actually, of all the people to convince to eat raw food, they'll be the easiest, and that's an interesting point. Convince anybody to eat raw food, that's a tough sell. But if you're going to try to sell that idea to the Eskimos, it's an easier sell for them because the word Eskimo is derived from an American Indian language. And it means he eats it raw. He eats it raw. That's what Eskimo means. And when you look at our species, we've been eating cooked food consistently for about 60,000 years. The Eskimos only have done this recently. So actually, it'd be a lot easier to convince them to go back to that unless they're just addicted to their food like everyone else is. And this is the problem. So cooked food addicts and apologists try to rationalize why we can't eat raw food. Well, yes, we don't live in an ideal world anymore. How do you feed everybody when they're not living in the right place? Well, if we can reach the tipping point and get connected, we'll have plenty of food to grow because you can grow more food per acre using fruits and nuts than just about any other food. Have you never been to an orchard? Have you never been to a blueberry farm? Again, there's no reason why this whole field couldn't be covered with food. Where everywhere we go, we got food, except for places we're not meant to live. But if we get our act together, we can possibly populate the whole planet and just ship the food out there. And it won't be costing anybody anything. But the chances are, once we wake up to this reality of what we're supposed to be doing, I have a feeling a lot of people, even though their ancestry goes back to a certain area, they're going to want to get out of there. And a lot of people aren't going to want to. But I can see why a lot of people will migrate to a climate that's more soothing, so we can be out here like I am, half naked, which is how you're supposed to be. In fact, I can feel sweat perspiring off me right now. And there's not any kind of a breeze going on right now, but if I was wearing a shirt, I'd be sopping wet right now. I walked to the store the other day with a shirt, and I was fit to be tied by the time I got home because I had this wet shirt on me, and it was so hot, my skin couldn't breathe. So a good rule of thumb, if you have to wear clothing to live where you're living, you're really not living where you're meant to live. Doesn't mean you can't live there and you shouldn't be able to enjoy the beauty that's up there. But keep in mind that if you're going to do it now, it might not be as easy for you to satisfy your needs as well as you can. So what do we do if we live in England and we don't have enough money to buy the fruit because it's so expensive? Well, you make do, don't you? You eat the next best food. You go to your grains, your whole plant foods, and you go ahead and cook them. But now you're cooking them. You're better off learning how to sprout that food instead. So we can get around the cooking issue by going to Sprouts. So there's an option there. However, we really need to look at what's most sustainable for us to do in the long term And that is to go back to the diet we were meant to eat. And that's a raw vegan diet. So I know how hard that is for most people. I know most people have a hard time eating better of the good, more of the good stuff and less of the bad stuff. So where do you start? Well, the best way to start is to give yourself a solid food vacation. When we get reconnected and change our collective mentality, we will have a form of collectivism and anarchy at the same time, where we realize the solution has to do with a principle called autarky, where the individual and the collective are both recognized. Why? Because we corrected five main mistakes. What's the first one? Cooking our food. It's the first big mistake. If we didn't make that mistake, we wouldn't be eating animals. That's the second mistake. Then we wouldn't be eating grains. That's the third mistake. Thank you, the agricultural revolution. Then we wouldn't be processing our foods. There's the industrial revolution when we started making machines. And then the chemicals, my God. But what we have to realize is we really do need to work upstream and downstream. And to finish my point, by working downstream, we have to take back control of the money. We have to become self-sufficient as a nation. We are conquered by debt right now. And most people around the world are under the same predicament. And we need to change that. So if you are looking at politics, for example, how do you use a raw food, cooked food perspective to understand politics? Well, you have to understand the only people really qualified to be our leaders are people who've gone where few have gone, so they can lead us to where we need to go. So if they don't understand the raw food, cooked food connection, if they don't understand that cooking our food's the fall of mankind and that's the only thing we should devote our energy toward, then they're not our solution. We live on an abundant planet. Two countries proved that to us, to the world. They were flourishing when the rest of the world was starving. How can we be starving on an abundant planet? Scarcity is an illusion. And that is one of the most important illusions that the people who rule the world want us to believe in, and there's a lot of invested time and money in making us believe certain things so we'll never see that connection. That's why we don't understand the real truth about what happened last century. Because when we attack people, it's because the people who rule the world want us to attack them, because they're usually proving to everyone else that we live on an abundant planet. And that's what happened to Germany and Japan. They were proving to the world, look what happens to us when we don't let someone else print our money and take away all the money and profits and make us pay interest on it. Look what happened to us. Look what we did to our country. We went from the poorest to the richest. They called it the German miracle. We've been lied to about history so that we don't learn we live on an abundant planet. The illusion of scarcity is one of the biggest lies told by the biggest liars in the world who rule the world. You have to understand that's what they are. They're psychopaths. We got to have that raw food mentality. Otherwise, it's the wrong mentality. And why is it wrong? We destroy the biophotons. What are biophotons? It's coherent sunlight energy that we store in the nucleus of our cells. It's faster than the speed of light. Ties into an experiment I did called the EPR paradox. I want to start out with P instead of E. The EPR paradox. And it's been duplicated many times where they prove that faster than light communication exists. That's our sixth sense. It's our spidey sense. And it's too low, man. That's why everything has to be understood from our biophoton level. So if we're going to talk politics, if we want to have leaders, our leaders have to have an optimum biophoton level. We should only have one law. In fact, if I was to be president, here's an idea. Let's vote John Rose for president. And I'll have two laws. One has to do with biphoton levels. Everyone has to have a minimal biphoton level, and we'll be real generous in the beginning. But politicians have to have an optimum biphoton level, because these are our leaders, and we can't have leaders if they don't know where to go. And then, interestingly, if you're a criminal and you still can't behave properly, you too will have to have an optimum biphoton level. We're not going to let you have a minimal biphoton level, because apparently you can't handle a little bit of the wrong stuff. Then the other law I'd have, and this goes back to the book by John Adams, Wealth of Nations, where he said there's three groups of people: those who live by wages, by rent, and by profit. And the first two groups, those who live by wages and those who live by rent, they have the same interests as everyone else. But those who live by profit don't have the same interests as the public. Because they want to narrow their competition and widen their market. So the other law is that no one who lives by profit can communicate to any of our leaders. There's no communication, verbally and financially. That's how you get the money out of politics. Everybody who's in there making money cannot communicate to our leaders. Once we reach the tipping point, once we change collectively and our mentality changes, we won't have an exchange mentality anymore. We'll have a gift mentality. We'll have a resource-based economy. And the reason is because we'll bump up our biophotons, we'll feel connected to everything around us, and then we'll realize, hey, if I'm part of everything, how can I improve my life? No brainer. Let me improve everything around me. And everyone's going to have that mentality. And the more we give, the more we receive. Life is an illusion. We live on an abundant planet. But you've been tricked into thinking there's scarcity. You've been tricked into thinking Germany and Japan did something bad. They did something good. They stopped letting someone print their money. They flourished when everyone else was starving. Why do you want your children to starve? Why do you want your children to be slaves? Why are you a slave? Why can't you wake up? Your brains are bombarded with bullshit. You're brain dead. Most people are brain dead. Because you've had so much bullshit bombarded in your brain, you can't allow raw food to come into your life. You can't allow the concept that there are psychopaths who rule the world come into your life. And we don't want to put too much attention on these psychopaths. Again, it doesn't matter who they are. We just got to be aware that they're there and do damage control based on what they did. And the main thing they've done is they've taken our government and are using it to control us. So we got to change all the bullshit in there and replace all those stupid laws with two laws, biophoton levels, and those who live by profit, until we change our mentality where no one's going to think like that anymore. But when you stop cooking your food, you start realizing, hey, I'm sensing something. Kind of reminds me how I felt when I was a kid. Because according to Dr. Pop, we start off at 43,000 biophotons. Most of us are around 1,000 to 23,000 biophotons, when we should be 83,000 biophotons. And number one way to heal alternative in Germany is a juice fast, 114,000 biophotons. I've gone through such an array of emotions this morning. I love the Howard Beale speech. I can listen to it dozens of times over and over, and I usually do. And the whole time I'm ecstatic. Tears are pulling out of my eyes. I'm laughing. I'm elated, thinking, yes, this can be done. This can be done. And then I thought about, well, let's see, how can I follow up this video, this introduction? And I initially thought of following that up with a bunch of YouTube videos of children being given chemo. So I watched about a half a dozen of those, and I was bawling like a child, man. Don't you guys understand what they're doing? I'm all teared out, man. I am totally teared out. Oh, that's all I did all morning long. I was bawling with laughter and enjoyment, listening to Howard Beale motivating people, and then watching these children being given chemo and going to the hospital. And, oh, God, what are we doing? When are we going to put an end to this? If that doesn't piss you off, what is wrong with you? If you're not outraged, you're totally naive, or you shut off your frontal lobe, you don't want to give it any thought. And it's understandable. Like the people in that movie, Network, they were helpless. They felt helpless. So, yeah, if that's the situation, if there's nothing we can do about it, that makes sense. So it goes back to the Serenity Prayer, which comes from Epictetus. God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and wisdom to know the difference. The vast majority of our problems are 100% within our control, but we lack the wisdom to know the difference. That's our problem. We've been duped, we've been tricked by the sickest of us, who are exploiting the sickness in man. Why do we have depression? Why is there depression when we live on an abundant planet? Well, go back into 1913 here in America. We had corrupt politicians that sold their soul, made a deal with counterfeiters, gave them a 20-year contract, which we renewed over five times, are still in existence here. And we gave a deal to these counterfeiters and said, look, you know, we know we can print our own money, make our own money. That's what we have power to do, but we're going to give that job over to you. And what do? They print the money out of thin air for the price of paper and ink. Then they charge us the principal plus interest. There's not enough money in print that's been in circulation that's been printed that can even pay back the interest, so we're debt slaves. That's what John Adams meant when he said there are two ways to conquer a nation. One is by the sword and the other is by debt. We are debt slaves. So in 1913, the Federal Reserve Act was passed. Now, that dollar is worth less than a nickel. It's worth less than 4 cents, and that's by design. They want to keep us poor. We're debt slaves. There's not enough money in circulation. Don't think the money issue is too complicated for you to understand. All you got to do is be against it. Voltaire said, to learn who rules over you, find out who you're not allowed to criticize. You can't even question the Holocaust in, 14 countries in Europe? What is that all about? Now, you got to keep in mind, the people who rule the world are Satanists. And they decided to disguise themselves, hide themselves within the Jewish religion, and sort of take it over. So that we can then have a scapegoat. It's the Jews, it's the Jews, it's the Jews. So how many people do you hear say, the Jews, look at them, look at them, look at them. No, they're Satanists, they're Zionists. They took over that religion because they got to keep us distracted. There's layers upon layers upon this, and I don't even care how many layers there are, and I don't know. It doesn't matter. We just got to correct what they've done. But then what they do is then they get the Christians and the Muslims to fight against one another. So that's what they've done. It's all about divide and conquer. When you study the MO of psychopaths, who the rulers of the world are, they are psychopaths. You couldn't do what they're doing unless you were a psychopath. And they consider themselves superior because they can step on us like an ant, and they don't have any remorse for it. And they therefore think they're superior. We don't care if we slaughter you. We get you guys to fight wars with one another. They finance both sides. It's all about divide and conquer. Remember that great speech by Martin Luther King within 24 hours when he was to be murdered? He knew it. And he gave that speech and said, look, man, I know they're coming for me. I'm not going to be around much longer. And when I'm gone, they're going to use an old favorite formula of the pharaohs. And the pharaoh a long time ago knew what to do because it's the same people. It's these Satanists. And they're going to use an old favorite formula of the pharaoh. And that is to get you guys to fight amongst yourselves. You see, that's what it's all about. Man, woman, Christian, Muslim, black, white. It's all a distraction. We're always being distracted.
Good day. How are you?
Good over, guy.
I have a question.
Say again?
I have a question. It makes sense for you if they say
Hare Krishna.
One man died for all of us.
Does it make sense for me for one man to die for all of us?
Yeah.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Does it make sense to me?
Yeah.
Can I be honest? No.
No. What?
No. I'm a good man, but no, it doesn't make sense that he would have to, that accomplishes anything. I don't believe in animal sacrifice any more than I believe in human sacrifice. I think it's absurd. If I make a mistake and I do something bad, Let me go get this bird over here, this dove. God, I'm going to show you, I'm really sorry, I'm going to kill the bird for you. But now it makes even less sense for me. I'm going to do it to a person. Yeah. It really doesn't, my friend. I'm a good guy. But I understand the message has been twisted. People don't want us to really understand it wasn't how he died, it's how he lived. Think about this, my friend. It was his life that we must follow. His death is to trick you into thinking it's all about the afterlife. It's here, right, and now. We have to live the way Jesus lived. Do a Google search for Essenes. Think about this. Why are there 33, there's so many years missing in Jesus' life that's unaccountable? Well, it's because it explains how he really lived. He was an Essene. Not just any Jew, he was an Essene Jew. And they understood that there were how do they say it? Angels of light, angels of death. Angels of light. It wasn't angels, that's what's confusing me. There was a light and a dark, in other words. And they were of the light. And there were the darkness that trick people and fool you. And what they do is they change stories just a little bit to trick us so that we don't really focus on what's important. So I understand there's a real important message with Jesus, but we're being tricked into thinking he died for us. Think about it logically. What good does it do? I'm going to kill a bird. I'm going to kill a man. Sacrifice doesn't make sense. Just think about it. We've been tricked into believing that. What really matters is that Jesus lived a certain way and he fasted. And this is what I do. I'm on a mission to help people do what Jesus did. In fact, there's another man who did what I'm trying to do again. Bill Bright. You heard of Bill Bright? Heaven is right here. Even Jesus said, heaven is here right now. We make our own hell because we're not eating the right food. Genesis 1:29 is the only time in the Bible where God told us what to eat. We're not doing that anymore. That's how we got kicked out of the Bible. But they changed everything around where we don't focus on Genesis 1:29. Think about it. You know Genesis 1:29. It's the only time God said, this is what you're supposed to eat. And guess what? If you don't eat it, you get kicked out of the garden. A garden is only a place where we don't have problems that are within our control. What's within our control? What we eat. How did we get out of the garden? We needed the right food. It wasn't this tree of knowledge, good and evil. It was we took knowledge we learned and we applied it to our food. That's how we got kicked out of the garden.